Thanks for having me, and as Dr. Boris said, today I'm going to be discussing some of my doctoral research activities. This has pretty much all been covered. The only thing that I would point out is I'm in the Michael Yabsley lab at the Southeastern Cooperative Wildlife Disease Study. It's a specialized research center at UGA that specializes in the research of wildlife diseases that with also an emphasis on potential public health risks and risks to domestic animals. So it's kind of a one-of-a-kind program. And of course, my primary interest as a researcher is in the biology and epidemiology of various zoonotic helminths. I was bitten by the parasitology bug thanks to a particular faculty member here, which drew me away from plants, and I'm sure Dr. Boris is still a little bit bitter about that to this day. I'm just kidding. But this is where I've ended up. So, as the title suggests, the star of our show is the raccoon roundworm, Baylisascaris procyonis. It's a large intestinal nematode in the family Ascaridae. These are often referred to as ascarids in the veterinary and human health practice. It's actually closely related to more familiar species such as Ascaris lumbricoides of human and the various dog and cat roundworms that you see in veterinary practice. When I say large, I do mean large. The females can reach up to 25 centimeters in length. This is the biggest one I've ever pulled out of a raccoon. So very big. And the males don't get quite as big. They're about 10 centimeters. And the thing about ascarids, which is really fascinating, is that they are extremely prolific in their reproduction. One female, especially a large female like this, can produce upwards of 100,000 eggs per day. And when you get a very large infection in a raccoon, this is a worm burden from a single raccoon. You can get quite a lot of eggs in the feces of these raccoons. The larvae, the immature stage, is smaller. They hatch out at about 200 microns in length and reach 1800 microns by the time they are fully developed larvae. The eggs, you can see on the left here, are extremely environmentally hardy. And about 70 to 60 microns in diameter. So, as the name also suggests, the raccoon is the reservoir for this parasite and is also what's called the definitive host. And definitive host refers to the host in which a parasite reaches maturity and reproduces. While the definitive host range is narrow, the intermediate host range is one of the broadest known to parasitology. Larval infections have been documented in upwards of 150 species of mammals and birds, and also infects humans. And intermediate host, I'll use this term quite a bit throughout the talk, so just important to keep this in mind, is a host in which the immature stages or larvae infect, but development to adulthood does not occur. Now this will make a little more sense when I show the life cycle here. So the life cycle of this parasite goes as follows. The adult nematodes are in the small intestine of the raccoon definitive host. They mate and produce eggs, which are then shed in the feces. These eggs are passed in the feces as just this undeveloped zygote. And in the environment, over a period of about 14 days, the zygote will divide and develop into a second stage larva. And once these eggs are embryonated, they are infectious to either young raccoons in this direct kind of cycle, or they're infectious to a number of intermediate host species, like this groundhog here that's a very typical intermediate host species in the wild. When these intermediate host species ingest these eggs, the larvae hatch out of the egg, penetrate the small intestine of this host, and then migrate throughout the host tissues. Baylisascaris is particularly known for invading the brain and spinal cord of the host and producing severe neurological disease. And in this state, in the wild, an intermediate host is writhing around on the ground in the throes of neurologic disease. Obviously, this is easy pickings to a raccoon who will just come along and eat this vulnerable host, or just scavenge ones that have died from this disease outright. And then the larvae within the tissues of this intermediate host reach the small intestine of the raccoon and then mature into adults, and that completes the life cycle. So the disease caused by larval migration of Baylisascaris through tissues is referred to as Baylisascariasis. And this kind of falls under three larva migrant syndromes, or just syndromes associated with larval migration, like the name would suggest. And there are three sort of manifestations of this. Visceral larva migrans refers to migration through visceral organs, particularly the liver and lung. This can cause some sort of non-specific signs. Neural larva migrans is invasion of the brain and spinal cord. And then ocular is through the eyes, obviously. It was first recognized as a zoonotic disease in about the 1980s. And since then, there have been about 50 confirmed neural and ocular cases in humans. And an important aspect of this is that the case fatality rate for neurologic larva migrans is over 40%. So this is a very serious disease. And even all but about 2 or 3 survivors have experienced permanent brain damage because these larvae are so big and they migrate so aggressively through these tissues. With ocular cases, this can cause permanent vision defects, although this usually presents without concomitant neurologic disease. And this isn't restricted to just humans. There have been plenty of mortality events in livestock, wildlife species, and captive exotics particularly. There have been several outbreaks documented in zoos where raccoons get into an enclosure of an animal and contaminate the feed and water with eggs. That's pretty sad. And the treatment is complicated and expensive for neural larva migrans. It's very difficult because once you start seeing these neurologic signs, it's pretty much too late to do anything. The damage has been done. And also, the drugs used to treat this don't pass the blood-brain barrier very effectively to actually kill migrating larvae inside. So there have been some successes lately with very early and aggressive treatment with antihelminthics or antiparasitic drugs and corticosteroids, but then again, that's it's very hit or miss. And the picture here is actually a larva in cross-section through host tissues. I'm not sure which species this host species this is. But as you can see here, here's a cuticle of the worm. Baylisascaris procyonis has these two projections on the side called allae, which can be useful in the diagnosis if you can get your hands on a cross-section. And here's the intestine of the worm. And this top picture is it's probably one worm weaving in and out of the plane through which this section was taken, just to orient yourself to that. So Baylisascaris procyonis is native to North America. Generally, the prevalence decreases along a north-south gradient. It's most common up in the upper Midwest and Northeast, also the West Coast. And prevalence can reach up to 80 to 90% in these regions. Basically now it's found wherever raccoons are found across North America. However, the prevalence or how common it is will vary greatly depending on many factors. And I'd like to emphasize that there's really been a lack of systematic surveillance for Baylisascaris procyonis up until recently when it was recognized as a potential public health issue, right? That's what gets the money coming in. So there are still many things we don't know about the current prevalence or distribution. And there have been recent introductions into the Southeast and Southwest where it was historically absent. In the Southeast, in Georgia actually, the first documented case of Baylisascaris in a raccoon was from 2002 in DeKalb County. And this was probably a case of a raccoon that was brought in from a more northern state to a rehab center and then released into the wild. And it's also made its way across the globe. This has also been introduced into Europe, Japan, China, and Costa Rica with raccoon movements across the world. In Europe, it's primarily for the fur trade because raccoons have a very nice, valuable pelt, especially in these northern cold climates. Japan is an interesting case. In the 1970s, there was a very popular cartoon in Japan called Rascal the Raccoon, about a boy and his adorable, funny pet raccoon. And of course, what do people do when they see this? Oh, raccoons make great pets. Let's import some from US and Canada. And so they did. And with it, they brought every pathogen and parasite of raccoons over there. So that's how it ended up in Japan. And now raccoons are considered invasive in Japan, because they come in, they're cute, they're little, they're sweet, and then they hit sexual maturity and they become this raging monster and they don't want anything else to do with them. They just shoot them out the back door. In China, a similar kind of issue, probably imports for zoological gardens and private collections. Costa Rica, we're not sure how it got there. There's still some questions about the validity of that report. All right, so maybe I'm hopeful, but I hope you noticed the term One Health in my title. So let's discuss what this term means. Is it just a buzzword so you would actually come to my talk or attached to other research just to make it look, you know, nice and pretty and wholesome? Or is it actually the real deal and relevant to my work and others? I'm probably preaching to the choir here because Barry has his own One Health program, which is great. It was developed after I left, unfortunately, but I think kind of the prevailing mindset here really helped cement my interest in it. So if you're not aware, One Health is this sort of intersectional, integrative approach to studying disease, health and disease of the globe. And it emphasizes researching human health, environmental health, and animal health, and seeing how all of these interact to create disease processes. So the projects that I have going on with my doctoral research all kind of fall in these intersectional areas. So hopefully you'll agree that One Health does kind of fit with this system I'm about to discuss. So now I'm going to go through some of the more individual projects that are either done or mostly done and sort of discuss the premise behind them and some of the results thus far. First up, we did some work looking at exposure of wildlife rehabilitators to Baylisascaris. And this was in collaboration with the CDC Parasitic Diseases Branch and was recently published in Emerging Infectious Diseases. This is another Barry connection, actually. Our previous faculty, I believe he's fully retired now, Dr. Joe McDade, was once the deputy director of the CDC, and he founded this journal. So it was kind of a bittersweet moment to be able to put this in EID because he was such a mentor to me during my time at Barry. All right, enough sentimental stuff. Let's talk about Baylisascaris as a zoonotic disease. So I said previously it is rare. There's only been about 50 confirmed cases in people, but incidence appears to be increasing in recent years. And most likely this is actually just due to better diagnostics, more awareness, but I believe that factors such as the geographic expansion of the parasite and the ever-increasing density of raccoons in urban areas cannot be ignored in this. And the cases that exist have generally been only in children and toddlers or mentally disabled people that tend to engage in geophagy or eating dirt or would potentially have oral contact with raccoon feces. There's some limited evidence out there that adults can have asymptomatic infections, that they don't always develop this severe neural larvae migrans, and infection may go unnoticed. And why would this be? We believe that this is a question of dose, simply. So you think about these children, they're nasty, they explore the world with their mouths, they're digging around in the sandbox, they find, you know, a nice solid raccoon poop with embryonated eggs, and they stick it in their mouth. And when you consider that the average infected raccoon has an egg burden in the feces of about 26,000 eggs per gram. That is a lot, that's a massive dose, especially for these children that directly consume raccoon feces. An adult, I really hope, is less likely to infect themselves that way. They're more likely to become infected through more indirect means, such as contaminated soil or objects or wood logs outside. So they would be getting a much smaller dose of eggs and probably not develop the same kind of severe disease that the children would. And this mirrors the story of a related ascarid, Toxocaricanus, the canine roundworm. It was once thought to be kind of an inconsequential zoonotic disease, really rare, didn't really matter. But recent studies have shown that 14% of people in the United States have antibodies to this, indicating a prior infection with this. And furthermore, these so-called covert or more subclinical infections have been statistically associated with asthma, urticaria, which is random unexplained itchiness, cognitive delays, and even occult seizures that are not explained by any other factors. So we hypothesized that Baylisascaris is following a similar story, that infections in people could be occurring covertly or without overt symptoms. And of course, some populations are going to be more at risk than others. So we decided to study this in wildlife rehabilitators because they have such constant contact with raccoons and their feces over long periods of time. So we set out to determine the seroprevalence, or simply percent of the population that is positive for antibodies to Baylisascaris, and then identify some risk factors associated with this exposure. So we designed this study. We went around to national and regional wildlife rehabilitator meetings and set up a table and enrolled people. And we gave them a 31-item questionnaire to assess their rehabilitation history, demographics, their practices when they're handling raccoons, etc. And then we also drew blood and performed antibody detection using a Western blot that was developed at CDC. And this Western blot works pretty well as a diagnostic assay. It has 88% sensitivity and 98% specificity. And this is just what it looks like. You have a strip of nitrocellulose with an antigen in it, and this dark line indicates a positive result. So we enrolled 347 people. Almost all of them were white and female, and through no bias of our own, this is just how the wildlife rehab community is. There is a large age range, and almost all were currently involved in wildlife rehabilitation, with a smaller proportion reporting former or some kind of other wildlife contact besides rehab. And there was also a wide range of experience, all pretty equally represented in these categories, from very inexperienced to extremely experienced. So when we assessed their use of personal protective equipment in different situations, we found some pretty expected, but also some interesting results. So using gloves when handling live animals was kind of 50-50. Masks were not a popular item to use as protection. And almost everybody reported washing their hands after handling live raccoons. Of course, these are self-reported answers. You have to take that with a grain of salt. With dead animals, we found pretty similar patterns. But more people wash their hands and use gloves, which shows us maybe they are kind of aware of this zoonotic disease risk, which is what we like to see. Importantly, after raccoon feces contact, almost everybody reported washing their hands, but not all. That's the thing that gets me. So there were about 7% that did not wash their hands on an always basis after cleaning cages. And about 3/4 did this every day. So there's quite a risk of exposure there, just from the frequency at which they are in contact with raccoon feces. We asked a little bit about parasite control. It's hard to get really, really good quality answers with this because a lot of people don't know, or they're unaware, or they vary their protocols every so often. 57% said they have observed nematodes passed in raccoon feces. And this would probably be consistent with Baylisascaris. There wouldn't be very many other large nematodes that would be passed that way. However, a smaller proportion actually reported that the diagnosis was confirmed in their facility. So some people are seeing this, but either not knowing what it is or not bothering to get a diagnosis in their captive animals. And 88% reported that they deworm the raccoons regularly. Although what regular constitutes and what drugs are used are highly variable among rehabbers. But unfortunately, we were not able to assess that with this study. So good stuff. 24 people were positive for antibodies in our study. The yellow circles indicate where individuals originated from or where they practice rehab, county level for US, township for Canada. And the red dots indicate where the seropositive individuals were located. The shading of the states and provinces, I put this map up before, but just want to reiterate, is the reported prevalence of Baylisascaris in raccoons, with the darker states being higher prevalence down to low or unknown or absent for these lighter ones. And again, as I said, take this with a grain of salt because there are still many gaps in our knowledge on distribution. But currently, this is the only way we have to assess risk based on geography. And as you can see, almost all of the positives were in states where Baylisascaris has been reported. Only one was in kind of an unusual area, which was Alabama. However, the neighboring county over in Florida actually did have confirmed Baylisascaris in raccoons at about a 15% prevalence. So again, it's probably there, just not been looked at. We did some risk factor analysis, and this is statistics, so don't read this too hard, but just wanted to emphasize that the significant risk factors were region, practicing rehab in the western region was significantly associated with a positive antibody result. And similarly, when we analyzed by prevalence of the state, so the shading in that previous map, unsurprisingly, rehabbing in a region where Baylisascaris is hyper-endemic or over 50% prevalent in raccoons was also a significant risk factor. And this should also come as no surprise. So PPE compliance is also significant, including washing hands consistently after handling live raccoons and after fecal contact. Big surprise there that those would be associated with exposure to Baylisascaris. So in conclusion, we did find 7% seropositive in our study, and the significant risk factors being the western region, hyperendemic region, and also the inconsistent hand washing factor. So what do we recommend to rehabbers? Because we don't want to just go in and talk about this and just scare them by just leaving them out in the cold. So we tell them some pretty obvious things: to wash their hands and wear gloves when they're handling live raccoons, when they're cleaning cages, deworm their animals regularly and with correct drugs, clean enclosures with their heat methods. And I didn't mention this, I did mention the eggs were extremely hardy. They're hardy to the point of being completely impervious to disinfectants. So bleach, Lysol, nothing actually kills them. Only very high heat kills them. And they're also quite resistant to freezing as well. So even when we have these eggs in the lab, just to show how hardy they are, we actually keep them stored in formalin and they're perfectly fine. And it's actually a great way to store them because bacteria don't grow in there either. But yeah, very few people actually bother to sanitize their cages with heat. And also, as much as they can care for their captive raccoons, you have no control over wild ones that are very potentially infected. So minimize wild raccoon presence around the home and the facility. And one very easy way to do this is don't feed your cats outside, because this is just like a big buffet for raccoons. It's easy pickings. So I would strongly advise against that. So we did add to the evidence that Baylisascaris can occur subclinically or covertly. And potentially this is an underrecognized disease, given that it may not always present in this very severe neurologic manifestation. However, there's still a lot more work we need to do to understand the epidemiology of this covert Baylisascaris in humans. And of course, we came to the conclusion that through all of these meetings we went to enroll people, that ongoing awareness and education are very necessary, because we found a wide range of awareness about this. Some people had zero clue what it was. They're like, oh yeah, my raccoon, they have worms all the time, but I don't know what they are. They're just supposed to have them, right? I'm like, And then some people are actually, you know, vets or master students, and they actually knew what this was and had very good questions about their biology for me. So very diverse group. And this inspired our next study, which is a survey-based study. This is getting away from lab work a little bit. We wanted to assess the knowledge, attitudes, and correct practices that these rehabbers are employing with their captive raccoons, because Baylisascaris is potentially an occupational hazard for them. So as I said, very wide range of professionalism and training in this community. The setups range from very sophisticated, dedicated facilities that have veterinarians on staff, to individuals who rehab will have a litter of baby raccoons in a cardboard box in their bedroom. So our goal was to assess knowledge gaps and attitudes and also infection control practices among these rehabbers, and then identify what factors influence these responses to sort of better further our educational efforts. So we had 656 complete responses, which was really great because the survey was extremely long. And I'm going to talk about just a small part of it here because there was so much data. We've collected so much data. So for the knowledge portion of the survey, there were 14 knowledge questions, and they're basically like quiz questions, true, false, multiple choice, covering aspects of Baylisascaris biology, transmission, and clinical signs. And we got a really nice kind of normal distribution of knowledge score, ranging from none correct to all correct. And the median was right at 50%, or 7 out of 14 correct. So there's kind of this intermediate or wide range of knowledge present, no surprise. And also, I don't have time to go through all these individual questions, but these are the questions we assessed. And there was really almost another perfect gradient between questions that almost everybody got right, including Baylisascaris, is Baylisascaris contagious when in a person, which is no, and the route of transmission, which is fecal-oral. So everybody knew those, and then almost nobody knew at what age can raccoons begin passing eggs of E. procyonis, which is kind of an important thing for rehabbers who are dealing with these young raccoons to know when to initiate treatment. So I just thought that was interesting that there is this nearly perfect gradient of right and wrong. Wrong is red, right is blue, if that wasn't apparent. So we did a similar sort of risk factor analysis. We condensed knowledge score into sort of a binary outcome of scoring above the median or below the median, and then analyzed which factors contributed to differences between those. So factors that were more likely to score above the median were pretty unsurprising. Experience level was important. Members of professional rehab groups were more likely to answer above median or score above median. Those with a higher education level, and also those with a history of Baylisascaris diagnosed in their facility, which makes sense if you think about it. You know, if they get a confirmed diagnosis, they might actually be driven to find out more about it and actually retain that knowledge versus somebody who's never seen it in their life. Individuals who were part-time volunteers or just occasional volunteers did not score as well. Those with no direct contact with raccoons in the facility didn't either. And also, those in the southeast did not score well. And this isn't because Southerners are stupid. I'm a Southerner. I would never say that about myself, even though, you know, as a grad student, maybe sometimes I feel that way. But as I said, Baylisascaris is a very recent introduction in the southeast, so it hasn't been around a long time, and awareness may just be limited because it's a fairly new thing in raccoons, and it's still relatively rare in most places in the southeast. Like, I believe Chris Hall is doing some surveillance work for Baylisascaris, and you haven't found it in Floyd County, have you?
No, we haven't.
So it's still kind of spotty because it's a recent introduction. It may spread, it may become more established, but that's yet to be seen. So, emphasizes mentorship and education are very important in this community. So probably the best thing to do would be any new rehabilitator should join a professional group that will disseminate educational materials, and also maybe have a more experienced mentor to teach them correct practices. And this goes beyond just safety from zoonotic diseases and Baylisascaris. This will also extend into actual correct rehab practices, because a lot of animals die because people don't know what they're doing. So again, this was just kind of confirmed the obvious that mentorship is critical here. I'm switching gears a lot, so hang on with me. We did some experimental infection work in a natural host of Baylisascaris, the deer mouse. And so I did say this was One Health. They span a lot of aspects. I wish I could have a smoother transition between these two projects, but it is what it is. This work was actually published in the Journal of Parasitology last year. So Paraviscus. These are called deer mice. It's a genus of mice that's very widespread in North America. And they're in the wild, they're probably very common intermediate hosts for Baylisascaris. And the reason they're really common hosts is due to their feeding behavior, which is a foraging and caching behavior. So they'll forage undigested seeds and plant material from raccoon feces and either eat that right then or actually go back to their burrow and store it away. And obviously the storage is going to allow any eggs on this material to become embryonated and infectious, and then they're basically inoculating themselves when they eat that. There are many species in North America, and natural infections of Baylisascaris have kind of been sporadically documented in several different species, but in the literature only one species has been investigated as in the context of the ecology of Baylisascaris, and that's P. leucopus, the white-footed mouse. So we wanted to investigate species-level susceptibility to Baylisascaris among the many different Paramiscus species in the North America, because it does go beyond P. leucopus, and it was unusual to us that the literature was so restricted that way. So we designed an experimental infection trial where we infected four different species of Paramiscus with Baylisascaris to look at the infection dynamics and survival and tolerance. And so the four species are P. maniculatus, the deer mouse, and P. leucopus, the white-footed mouse, which is the most commonly or widely distributed and common Paramiscus species in North America. And we also included P. polianotis, the old field mouse, native to the southeast, and the California mouse, native to Southern California and the Baja Peninsula. And collectively, these species represent quite a range of habitat types, from the old field mouse in the sand dune and southern habitats to the California mouse and arid chaparral, and then these two species, which are basically everywhere. And these also represent a range of size. The old field mice are tiny, they're about 12 grams average. And the California mice are giant at about 50 grams, and the other two are kind of in between that. So we acquired captive bred mice of these species and enrolled them in our infection trial. So this is how it worked. We had 6 mice per dose group of the 4 species. These mice were given either 550 or 10 embryonated Baylisascaris eggs orally. And then we followed these mice until they either developed neurologic disease or at 45 days post-infection, in which the trial ended, so they were euthanized at either of those points. After euthanasia, these mice were skinned. Necropsy was performed to look for any lesions that might be evident grossly, and also examine the brains for larvae. And hang on with me, this is a really high-tech method here. So the brains are extracted from the skull, put between 2 glass plates, and squished flat. And then you look at this under a dissecting scope, and you can very clearly see any larvae that are within the brain tissue. And after this, the skeletal muscle and visceral organs were separated and artificially digested using a hydrochloric acid pepsin mixture, basically artificial stomach acid. And then this liberates any larvae that are in the tissues, which can then be plated out and counted. I'm going to show a video of what Baylisascaris neural larva migrans looks like in these mice. If you're sensitive, it might be hard to watch, but I assume you're all biology students, so this shouldn't be any big deal. So this is a white-footed mouse, P. leucopus, showing a facial tremor and a paw tremor. This is kind of an early stage. This behavior with the constant circling is extremely common. It was observed in all of the species. And then also spinal involvement with hind limb paralysis was evident in some of these mice. And that's a poor California mouse there, quite big. So it's a serious parasite. It does a lot of damage, especially in such a small brain. One larva in the brain of a rodent is invariably fatal. They're basically doomed. Oops. So in the 45-day trial, here are survival curves. The dark line is the high dose on all of these graphs. The dash is medium dose, or the 50x, and the dotted is the low dose. So overall, the high dose was nearly uniformly fatal for 100% of mice, except for this problem child here, P. californicus. One mouse hung on, but there's evidence that he didn't get all of the dose. So probably just a glitch there from our unfortunate small sample size, because these mice are expensive and per diems are expensive, so you deal with what you have. The medium dose was more or less like an LD50. About half the mice hung on in any species group. And the low dose basically didn't do very much except for in one individual. It was unlucky. We, as in our statistician, did survival analysis using Weibull regression, which is a non-parametric way to assess the probability of dying at any time point. And our final model for survival included dose as a highly significant predictor. Obviously, given that survival chart, you would see that that's probably the most important factor. But also, interestingly, species was important. So being a P. leucopus mouse, you are more likely to survive at any given time point versus any of the other species. So our final model was basically dose plus species. And despite the difference in species survival probability, the total numbers of larvae actually collected from tissues were remarkably similar across these species and across the doses. And if you look at the percent of larvae recovered as a function of dose, it's all pretty much the same. It's not significantly different. It's always sort of between 6% and 10%. So no matter how many you put in, you're going to get a certain proportion back out, it seems, or at least in our 10 to 500 eggs dose groups. And this has actually kind of been observed with other ascarids, such as Toxocaricanus and others. But it was kind of a surprise. And despite the numbers being really similar, the distributions were not that similar. So L3 larvae, or stage 3 larvae, in the brain up here, P. maniculatus had significantly more in the brain, at least at the high dose, than the other species. And down here in the visceral organs, P. leucopus, the gold bar, had significantly more larvae in visceral organs. And there weren't really any differences that were important within the skeletal muscle group. So this is kind of interesting. So P. leucopus was the winner, survived much longer, appeared more tolerant to severe baylisascariasis, defined as delayed onset of neurologic disease. So they didn't survive, they didn't live that much more, they just hung on longer. And we think this is because maybe once they're inoculated, they're actually walling off the larvae better in their visceral organs, and that's why we got more out of them from those viscera. And perhaps slowing down the migration of the larvae to the central nervous system compared to some of the other species. And despite the massive differences in size, that didn't appear to be important in how well these mice survived. So it became interesting to us why two sympatric species, the P. maniculatus and P. leucopus, would have different levels of tolerance. And I was just reading one day about microhabitat preference in paramiscus, and I found that P. maniculatus prefers arboreal habitat, where P. leucopus prefers more terrestrial or low-lying habitat. And I thought, huh, it's interesting. And then I read this paper that actually quantified where raccoons typically produce their latrines, which is a communal defecation site, really gross, but often serves as kind of a focus of infection in ecosystems. And Page et al. Found that raccoons actually preferentially put their latrines on more low-lying and flat substrate, like fallen logs or tree stumps, which would probably be more consistent with P. leucopus habitat. So basically what we concluded from this was that these sympatric species, even in the same area, are experiencing different levels of exposure and therefore selection pressure for tolerance. So Pelecopus is more likely to encounter this in its environment, so obviously there's more selection for one that can resist the infection somewhat. So these differences really need to be taken into consideration for future work on this. With the existing literature, only Pelecopus is discussed, and what's really unusual is that there's no mention of P. maniculatus captures, even in these sympatric areas. So we don't know if they're just assuming that everything is a Pelecopus, or if they're actually targeting Pelecopus. I think the former, because the species kind of look the same, at least in many areas. And so this could influence ecology, but again, it's hard to put this into context without further field studies. So it's really important when you get into disease ecology to really pair these experimental infections with field studies to get an idea of what's really going on. And this is potentially an important conservation issue. Many of these P. polionotis species, or beach mice, are extremely endangered to the point of where they're federally protected in their sand dune habitat, especially along the panhandle. And so these are pretty much naive to Baylisascaris. As I said, it's kind of a recent introduction, especially in the southeast. So as this continues to move southward, what does that mean for these extremely endangered and ecologically important mice species in the sand dunes? It'd be interesting to watch. Y'all are the first to see this project. Again, I make a jump here, but that has to be. We're doing some preliminary work on Baylisascaris and domestic dogs. I don't condone this picture. It was cute, but I don't condone keeping raccoons as pets or allowing them to have contact with other species, so there's my disclaimer. So when I said the raccoons are the only definitive host for Baylisascaris, I did lie. Dogs can actually serve as alternative definitive hosts for Baylisascaris in rare cases. So with dogs and Baylisascaris, about three different things can happen. They can develop intestinal infections with adult nematodes, just like a raccoon would, and pass infectious eggs in their feces. And they would be infected by the same way as raccoons, either consuming eggs or consuming an infected rodent or other host. They can also be intermediate hosts and experience larval migraines from the immature stages, just like those paramyscus do and just like humans. This is really rare. There's been about two or three documented cases of puppies having neurologic disease from Baylisascaris. It doesn't seem to happen very often. And the third thing, which is not really an infection, but they can serve as what we call transport hosts with spurious infections, which means they just eat raccoon poop and the eggs just simply pass through the gastrointestinal tract. But there's no actual infection, there's no adult nematodes present. So why does this matter? Obviously, dogs have close association with people. We invite them into our homes. That's my dog up there. They're basically family members. And dogs, unlike raccoons that defecate in latrine sites, will defecate everywhere. And so this is potentially a problem when they're bringing Baylisascaris even closer into a domestic environment versus where it might not be quite so close to people otherwise. And also, people aren't really aware that this can happen because it's seemingly uncommon or understudied. So obviously the public doesn't know, but maybe even veterinarians and diagnostic labs don't know. And the problem with this is, Baylisascaris eggs look they look close enough to Toxocaria canis egg to where a vet tech who's looking at a fecal exam in a hurry is probably not gonna stop and say, that egg is a little darker, a little bit more coarsely granulated than Toxocaria eggs. I wonder what this could be. They're just gonna say it's an ascarid and leave it. So really, this has been a sort of neglected area of Baylisascaris biology. So we have a collaboration with IDEX Laboratories, which is a large veterinary diagnostic company. They have reference labs across the nation that process lots of fecal examinations and other diagnostic tests. We got access to their database, and we recalled information on Baylisascaris positive dogs from 2013 to 2016. We had some associated information, including the location, age, breed, and also any other ova and parasites that were found in those exams. And this is really just descriptive for now. I'm not going to present a lot of stats because we weren't able to do a lot with the information that we have. This is more just descriptive, just putting this information out there. So out of about 9.5 million dogs that were tested, that's hard to see, there were 504 that had Baylisascaris positive, or had Baylisascaris eggs in their fecal exams. So that's only about 0.005% positive from the four-year span. And these are county-level reports of the positives. So the yellow counties are one report, and the orange are multiple counties. And most of these were kind of concentrated up in the Northeast, but that may just be a sampling artifact because the lab is based in Westbrook, Maine. But for the most part, these reports were found in areas where Baylisascaris is known to be common, with a few interesting exceptions. There are a few states that had never ever had a Baylisascaris report, but had positive dogs, including South Carolina, North Dakota, Montana, and then up through the Northeast, but that's hardly surprising because it's known to be up there, just hasn't been published on. A really interesting positive, which I couldn't map because R is stubborn about this, was from Alaska, Fairbanks County. Raccoons don't go that far north. So this is either travel related or perhaps infection with a different species of Baylisascaris than Procyonis. Baylisascaris transfugia is in bears up there, and that's fairly common, so it could be a case of that, but we don't know. But it was certainly fascinating to see. Some of these positive dogs were young puppies, less than 2 months old, which is really interesting for a reason that I'll discuss in a minute. And the range of positive eight dogs were from 1 month all the way up to 15 years. We had some information about the breed of dog, or at least the predominant breed. And so I classified them by their American Kennel Club classification, just to get an idea of what breeds might be more highly exposed. And we found that herding, sporting, and working dogs had a higher percentage of positives. And this is probably because those are dogs that are more likely to be outdoor or free-range dogs and have access to raccoon feces or infected intermediate hosts. And similarly, most of our positives were large dogs instead of small or medium, because I don't think you're really as likely to have like a free-range chihuahua. That's probably a bad idea. That wasn't super surprising. So overall with this, we found a low prevalence, but again, it could be biased downward, considering that IDEX is the top tier diagnostic company for veterinary purposes. It's only the people that really send their dogs annual exams and really want the best that bother to have a fecal exam read by them. So this prevalence could be higher in maybe stray dogs or dogs that don't get quite as much care. I would probably guarantee you that's the case, which will be interesting to look at them going forward. Many of these infections are probably spurious or transport host kind of cases from coprophagy or eating feces. And a way we know how some are due to coprophagy is the presence of this coccidian in their exam, which is Imeria. It's a protozoan. It's a common raccoon and rabbit parasite, but doesn't occur in dogs. So the presence of this in a fecal exam indicates that there's probably some consumption of raccoon feces. Doesn't necessarily mean that it's a spurious infection, but it can be indicative of that. And you might say, oh, who cares? It's just spurious. You're not really infected. But it's actually pretty risky because these dogs could be eating embryonated eggs and passing them in a way that is more likely to come in contact with humans, rather than having a real patent infection and passing unembryonated eggs. So just something to think about. And I mentioned the puppies. Infections in these extremely young puppies that are probably unlikely to have had much contact with raccoon feces or access to hosts indicates that there's some degree of vertical transmission going on, or transmission from the dam to her offspring, either through the transplacental route or the transmammary route. The canine and feline roundworms are both known to do those routes of infection. Well, transplacental for canine, transmammary for feline. So we do think that's actually happening. And that's been something that's been really elusive in the literature, so we were kind of excited to have some evidence to support that. And we're gearing up to do some experimental infections in dogs and raccoons this summer. Super exciting work. We're going to compare their pre-patent periods or period from between inoculation and the passage of eggs, the efficiency of different routes of infection, so that would be eggs versus larvae and tissues, and also their egg output compared to raccoons. Since they're not as natural of a host for this parasite, they may actually not have as many eggs in the feces because these parasites are suffering a little bit from not being in the natural host. So this will be really fascinating stuff to look at, and I'm really looking forward to it. So what do I hope to take away from all these seemingly unrelated projects? Baylisascaris procyonis, hopefully you have realized, is a really, really cool zoonosis. And it's quite amenable to study with this one health approach. And I've sort of put together this schematic of how everything is related. You have infectious infected raccoons sort of bordering this sylvatic or wild environment and domestic environment, and various cycles and transmission pathways associated with them. And importantly, what to take away here is that individuals who work with wildlife are kind of on the interface of this sylvatic and domestic environment. They may be the first to have zoonotic diseases spill over into them. So special care needs to be taken to study them and potential exposure or interesting spillover events there. And also that domestic animals can serve as bridge hosts that help the passage of pathogens or parasites from wild hosts to domestic and then into humans, given their close association with them. And so these integrated sort of approaches to disease biology are really amenable for the study of parasitic diseases because of the life cycle, the interactions, the multiple hosts, the interactions with environmental components in many cases. But this is certainly not the only system out there that's like that. There are many others, parasitic and not, that can benefit from this kind of approach. And it's really exciting to see Barry go forward with that One Health program and really instill this in up and coming researchers, because I know this was a fascinating thing for me when I was starting out, and made a graduate career out of it. So I hope the One Health program continues to flourish. Bunch of people to thank. All the study participants, especially in the sero survey, because most of them didn't really want to get blood, but they were just fascinated enough to where they did. Even though they were very scared, and many of them, we never had anybody pass out, but they came close. All the rehab organizations that made it possible, collaborators, co-authors, and of course the very math and natural sciences faculty, because I wouldn't be where I am without that support and that early training and discipline and all the fond memories staying in those glass study rooms until 10 p.m. at night, writing organic chemistry and life cycles and immunology and plant physiology on those glass